Curtain ground.
And image guided neurosurgery, micro neurosurgery, spinal instrumentation, and he has had so far award 20 awards, including the Neurosurgeon of the Year 2008 by the Congress of Neurological Surgeons USA. He had large number of publications, original publications. We'll looking forward to hear you.
Is how cost-effective EMR is possible in India. We are having technical glitches. The slide is not moving forward. So if you actually look at history, there's a famous saying that those who cannot remember the past are condemned to repeat it. So we have to learn from history. And when we go back to our own creation, the trauma center, or to AIMS, we have a very checkered past. Computerization was attempted many times. One major endeavor was in 1980s, and a major company won it. And although state-of-art software and hardware was installed, implementation failed miserably. So there's a major difference between installation and implementation. And that difference is actually the end user, that is you and me. Those people who are going to be using it. If we go back to the history of trauma center, this center was conceived in 1980s, which is around almost 30 years back, by AIMS itself. However, because of various reasons, was handed over to Delhi government for building the trauma center. Then it came back to AIMS. And finally, we started dry runs in 2006, became fully functional in 2007, and have continuously developed ourselves to come to this level in 2012. So there is no implementation, nothing which can be done overnight. From conception to realization, it takes a very long time. And I think the reason it took so long was interested or passionate individuals were not available in between. And when such individuals became available, the dream changed to reality. When we talk about computerization in ED or the emergency department, actually most of us, doctors and nurses and other healthcare professionals, do not really envisage any computerization. The only thing we expect is registration can be computerized, that is made on the computer. Other than that, ED is just a gateway to the various departments. So nobody really wants anything to be done there. But nothing can be further from the truth. However, expectations for computerization are very low among the general staff, healthcare professionals. This is not a very good thing. Michelangelo once said that the greatest danger for most is not that our aim is too high and we miss it, but that our aim is too low and we reach it. So if we want to gravitate towards mediocrity, it is always very simple. We have to aim high, irrespective of the challenges, then only we'll be able to achieve something. Most of you would have heard the various presentations done today morning by our nurses on the various processes which we have computerized. And I'll just name them and walk you through them again, not as a repetition, but as a reinforcement. This is the state of MLCs which you must have seen, which are made all over the country. Illegible, problems in storage, handwriting issues, and a huge other set of problems which the courts and the police are also aware of. In this scenario, we introduced the electronic MLC system in our trauma center, which was really a boon for all of us because suddenly the whole MLC, the paper, became a tamper-proof document for the doctors, the police, and the courts to rely on. There were a lot of challenges in just, you might think it's very simple, just put it on the computer and let it come out. There were huge challenges before us. The legal validity was one of the major challenges. And we spent almost 6 months to a year just trying to find out whether it was legally tenable to just produce it in one center in India and just, will the courts accept it? And we found no definite answer. So, after taking legal opinion, which never came from our own institute, we discussed with some judges, discussed with the police officials, and then we said, okay, fine, we will start it and then let us see how it does. So Dr. Sanjeev and myself took a decision. And one fine day, we just stopped the paper MLCs and started this, taking all the attendant risk which came with this decision. And I think it is now more than a year that we have been successfully printing every single EMLC through the computer. And this has been appreciated by the judges because I have also appeared in courts for various summons. Dr. Bhoi has also appeared in court. And the judges have always said this is a very nice concept which should be introduced in other hospitals also. So a very small thing, it doesn't take a lot of IT to make this. It's a very simple IT which is involved, yet the consequences can be humongous. Patient display system has also been talked about a lot since the morning. I'll just run a short video to show you. So if the patient is actually coming into the ED, you can see how much time it is taking for the data to be entered into the system. And alongside it, in the CPRS, right from the patient coming to the ED to the time his full note is made ready by the doctor, takes hardly 1 minute. Right from seeing the patient, logging into the system, opening the template, and printing that sheet, which is just attached into the file. So it is a very, very simple thing. And only if you provide a viable alternative to the doctors and nurses, which saves time, saves their work, and improves efficiency all around, will they accept it. So we managed to do this for CPRS. And that is the only reason we were able to obtain reasonable success with it. We are also able to get a lot of scores, which were talked about again in the morning, the ICU scores. The beauty of these scores is, in the normal practice, you have to calculate a lot of variables manually to come to a score. Here, the software does everything at the background, including getting all the vitals and the lab values from the system itself. So in effect, this is a completely hands-free system. You don't even have to touch it. Automatically, the variables are coming in from the lab. The vitals are coming in from the nurses, which are entering the vitals. And the system is continuously calculating various patient scores on the fly So we've just made the system calculated 1 hourly or 2 hourly, and so it keeps scoring a patient dynamically, so that any given point you know what the score of the patient is. And this can be very helpful to nurses and doctors who can prognosticate the patient's relatives. Because as we all know, patient is a very dynamic person whose prognosis can vary with time to time. These are the kiosks we installed in the emergency department. And the beauty of these kiosks is you can open up patients' images, do whatever work you're doing without you having to run around finding a computer to enter it. So they are unobtrusive, standing there against the pillars, and whatever you want to watch or write, you just see the patient. You can see the beds behind these. All these are patient beds actually in the emergency department, and we just utilize the pillar in the center and put kiosk all around it, so that technology can be available to every nurse and doctor when required. This is again a view of the emergency department where you're seeing all the nurses actually using it, entering it, updating the vitals or the patient display system. And this is done actually 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. So you need to have those resources or create those resources from the existing resources so that the system keeps working irrespective of what. Even when you have a surge, even you have a mass casualty, we actually tested out the system when on Holi, where there's a surge of patients. From an average of 150, we suddenly get around 400 patients on Holi. And we were still able to maintain, enter, and collate data for all the patients with the existing manpower. So that's a huge achievement in terms of resource mobilization. Cost effectiveness is not just in computers or software. It actually has to permeate every sphere of what you're doing in order to be actually cost effective. You might think that these printers are actually huge things out there, but they're actually very, very cost effective. The whole ED can print, or emergency department can print on one printer which is network enabled. And so I would say approximately 20 computers are sending input to one printer. And because you have a contract with the vendor on per page basis, it is very, very cheap compared to small printers. So our total bill for printing would be around 10 to 15,000 for the whole trauma center per month. And then to avoid misuse of papers, we actually color them and emboss them with our center logo. Because if you put just white papers everywhere, people misuse them for their own personal stuff. So for every small thing, you have to think and make sure the process keeps working. Because if the paper is not there, or the printer is run out of toner, or the printer is not working, whatever you might do will not work, because the end point, that is the printed sheet and putting in the patient file, will not be there. So you have to take care of the last mile connectivity also and ensure that you do it cost effectively. Call center is something we talked about, and which I'm very passionate, and I think Mr. Rohit will be talking about more. But what it entails is that as soon as the patient is registered in the emergency department, his phone number is sent in real time to the call center situated outside Delhi, and the agent there gives a phone call to the relatives or anybody who, or the patient itself, the phone is the patient, within half an hour of his arrival in the ED. You can imagine the empowerment of people, the poor people, who suddenly receive a phone call saying that is everything fine, we have logged your details in, and in case of any problem, you please let us know, in their own language, that is Hindi. So every single patient will get a phone call, and that itself increases the perception of care to the person who's actually getting the call. They feel ab to koi sunta hai hamara. Somebody is actually phoning them. And I've got so many people come and tell me ki this is something which they have never experienced before, that even before the doctor comes and sees them, they're getting a phone call saying that is everything fine or not, we have recorded your number. Without their spending a paisa on the system. And then the reason we want to actually give them a phone call or a welcome greeting is to verify the phone number, because the call center can only function if the phone number is correct and verified. So in case it is incorrect, the call center can't go, the phone can't go in, then the call center is supposed to phone up the ED and tell the nurses on duty that this phone number is not reachable, please get the right phone number and put it. So very small things are required at right in the very beginning, because once the patient is sent away from ED, the phone number will never be traced after that. So we had to work both in the emergency department and in the OPD basis to decrease the wait times for the patients and to empower them. That's the biggest thing which I think we have done, is to empower patients so that they do not have to depend on touts or middlemen for information or for getting work done. So I'll just quickly, because I'm already out of time, I'll just quickly run you through the current status of Vista. It is, we are spending around 25 lakhs a year on the implementation for Vista. And we have a fixed cost, we have spent up to 1.5 crores till now, over the last, I think, 5 or 6 years. And the recurring cost is also not very small. It's around 6 lakhs a month. However, it all pales into comparison when you really compare the cost for computerizing any center with those in the West. I would say we are less by a factor of 100, if not more. The real cost that we are spending for the level of IT implementation which we have at our center. And the benefits are for all to see. If you see for simple things like CT films, MRI films, which we are not now printing out, that itself is translating into more than 500,000 of savings a year. So huge direct savings as well as indirect savings are there, which obviously are incalculable. So the effects of IT are huge for any hospital center, and especially important for our hospitals in India. This is just the number of awards we've got over the last few couple of years, actually, for our implementation. I would like to end this presentation by saying that the only reason we have been able to achieve all this is because we have had the support of our mentors, our chief, who have allowed us to reach to this level. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Deepak. Any question to Dr. Deepak? Anybody would like to ask? Yes, sir. Identify yourself and then ask.
My name is Dr. N.P. Singh. I must congratulate JPNETC, Dr. Deepak Agarwal, and everybody in this. We have been associated with this development. And after having learned through the medical IT, we are trying to promote it in other hospitals in India, and we came across some problems for which probably Deepak Agarwal could advise us. When we wanted to take it further to other hospitals, then we found there are three categories of hospitals in India. One is the public and government hospitals, second is the private hospitals, and third is the hospitals in public sector, large hospitals like SAIL, Coal India, and others. And the need for all the three hospitals are totally different. When we go and talk in private hospitals, then the need is for billing. Whereas we go and talk in the government hospital, the need is how to avoid the queue, which is the best managed in JP UNITC, and the fund. When recently I went and met the Vice Chancellor of Indira Gandhi Institute of Medical Science in Patna, then he said, we are not AIMS, we can't spend that much. So we were thinking the Vista, whether it could be developed for three different market segments. Right, for example, public sector hospitals, like SAIL has a lot of hospitals with 600 beds. And they have the patient coming again and again. Whereas the AIMS, that's not the situation. Or a government hospital, that's not the situation. So these three different segments of the hospital, whether the software, same Vista, could be modified to take different segments. And then we could probably take it to further height, because the development which has been done by JPTCNN could be distributed within the country. Thank you.
What I feel is that one shoe cannot fit all. So you need to have customization. Vista is a very difficult thing to customize. And I think you should have add-on software which is easily available or built in-house to take care of functionality which is not core. And the core functionality should only be done by Vista. Rest of the functionalities like billing, accounts, stores can be managed by in-house software which are actually customizable to the user. And in India, it is a very, very different kind of store management in government hospitals, different kind of store and inventory management in private hospitals. So we will have to have, we have developed our own inventory module in-house so that it fits in perfectly with what the store people want. So you need to have a core software which takes care of the patient information and obviously surround it with a plethora of software which take care of individual requirements.
Yeah, I think billing is a simple bit. I think now most places the billing, and whether it's a department store, malls, otherwise in hospitals, so billing is not that much a problem. But customization according to the need is important, and I think that also can be done. You can scale it down, you can scale it up. That is also possible, but naturally you have to have a team, whether it's a small setup or it's a big setup. If it is a small setup, you need a smaller team. If it's a big setup, you need a little bit bigger team so that your support, 24-hour support for this is maintained. And because like EMLC, when they started, at, occasionally it would not work. And they had to come, even Deepak, Dr. Sanjeev had to come in the middle of the night to the emergency department. Because the easy thing at that time would have been, okay, allow manual EMLC. But then if you want the system to work, then naturally you have to go a little extra mile and then prove that, no, let's set the things right and we will only go for EMLC. So I think, and we have had problems for implementing Vista also, integrating with PECS also took a lot of time and effort. So and so this interface is extremely important, but billing of, I'm sure it's not that difficult to implement in, and most, I think most institutions now have e-billing, like e-billing for the patients as well as salary accounts of the institutions are computerized in most places, like banks. Yeah, Dr. Sanjeev.
Dr. Deepak, I think it was, I just wanted to ask you for the sake, because I want the audience to know that how actually we made the journey when really we implemented the CPRS system, you know, and the major hurdle is, you know, a perception of means or resistance from change, you know, to change, resistance to change. How actually we overcome that? I think you should a little bit highlight on that, because most of the nurses are sitting and doctors are sitting, and we really faced a problem in change in that, you know. So So how we made that difference, and that is so critical for people, senior people also here, residents, nurses, they are here. So they should understand how that has happened in our center. And in, that is one. And second is how also we also change the how we change the perception of these store officers, you know, when we really implemented that. So I like you to comment on those and try to enlighten the audience.
Thank you, Dr. Bowie. I'll take the second part first. When we tried to implement the computerization of the stores, there was a lot of resistance, I think. Firstly, because the store people felt that they will be more open, or the system will become more transparent and accountable, and they were not ready for it. Secondly, they thought that the workflow which they are used to would be affected and they will have to relearn the whole thing. So they were these were the two major problems which we faced. And because we had Dr. Bowie as medicine and store in charge, support from the top level is always important for you to implement anything. And that is one of the key messages, that unless you have a clinical champion who is ready to go the extra mile, you cannot implement anything. So because he said that, okay, I will support you in computerizing it, we could roll over all the protests and say that we will do it. The workflow will remain the same, a computer, and you have to manage it somehow or the other. And we faced a lot of problems, and it took almost 6 months before we could actually implement it. And this was a year and a half back. Now, I don't think anybody would even think twice before entering stuff into the computer for the stores. So all nurses, we had very senior, because the indent, if you all know, the indent is actually entered by the senior nurse. And they were not at all happy in using the computers, because they were not well versed with using computers, and they thought it was additional work. So we had the NIS, the nursing informatics, train them, teach them, cajole them, and I think over 6 months they all came to terms, they realized its benefit, they could see what's happening, and so that was a major, I would say, technology change for them, and that's what made the success, the senior nurses. For the CPRS, similarly, the resident doctors, there are supposed four specialties, so resident doctors and neurosurgery were doing it almost 100% simply because I was after them. Other departments, because the faculty were not after the residents were not doing it. Now that perception has also changed, and residents in all departments have now come up in entering into CPRS. So there's a, because the juniors are always adaptable to change. It is the seniors who require more motivation and efforts to see the benefits of the technology.
Yes. Please identify yourself and ask.
My name is Dr. Aruna. I'm from Sri Lanka. I have a question and a suggestion. The question is, Dr. Deepak, as we discussed yesterday, we have started actually computerizing some of our hospitals as far back as 2006. But as it was mentioned in the keynote address, it became a failure. The main reason behind this failure was, I think, it was the lack of supervision. So I want to ask you how that you have been supervising this project and to become it successful. And number two is a suggestion that is actually, I think Professor Sanjay Bhuye was there in Sri Lanka at my invitation, and where we presented software solution called T-Alert. When you mentioned about this call center, this came into my mind. T-Alert is something, the data set, which even from ambulance or any scene, will be sent to the relevant people as a SMS. This has been developed by one of our students, actually, who is doing medical informatics. So I propose that you incorporate into your system. So I'd like to get your answer for my first question.
For the supervision, it is extremely important that there is a clinician, who is passionate about it and who wants the system to succeed. And we call it a clinical champion. So unless the clinical champion is there in the ED, no system can ever succeed. It doesn't depend on the vendor. It doesn't depend on anything else. The clinical champion has to be there. For the ED, it was Dr. Bhoi. For neurosurgery, it was me. So because we were there, we wanted the system to succeed, it succeeded. And because we could cajole them, fight with them, with the nurses, with the junior doctors, eventually wear them down and see the advantages of the system. So you need to be ready for a very long battle or war if you are passionate, and that can only be possible if you are passionate about it and you believe in it. If you are not, then it will never work. If you yourself think it is not going to work, you will never ever be able to convince your juniors to make it. So that, I think, is the biggest point. So for the second suggestion which is there, it's an excellent suggestion. Only problem with our system is that our pre-hospital care is lacking. So we do not have organized pre-hospital care as of now. Once that comes in, it's already on our radar that if something comes up, every ambulance should have an ultrasound connected and with all the vitals coming into the system.
Thank you. Actually, at the moment also, we have started another program where actually, even my small village hospital is paperless. You would believe that. This is a, that project is going nicely. So in the future, I hope that it won't collapse. We will see what will happen. Thanks for your input.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, I think most important thing is if you believe in yourself. Your self-belief is extremely important that what you are doing is right. And then only you can push it. And change is always taken with resistance by anyone. It is never taken as very easily. At one time, I always give this example. In India, when State Bank of India was being computerized, banking, you know, they went on a strike against computerization. Today, who can imagine that banking is done without computer, including State Bank of India? So, but as we all have discussed, that it has, if we believe in, it is not only with computerization or CPRS or putting in records, it is with everything. Like my infection control team goes, everyone thinks that they are their enemies. They don't know when we see the reports. Now, when I saw the last reports, most of the areas have come sterile. So if they don't insist or persist, it will not happen. So this is something which has to be pushed by the senior, as you said, supervision. And then we cannot, if there is a problem at 1 o'clock in the morning, we should be there to answer that. We cannot say, okay, now you do it manually, we'll see in the morning. So it has to be dealt with immediately right there. Any complication or any hiccup in the system needs to be rectified immediately and as soon as possible. Then only it can be done. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Deepak.